Hey guys, so today we're going to answer a very interesting question. Can you save extra money with a Core i9 or the ASUS TUF gaming motherboard? So we're going to answer this question starting right now. Hey guys, RealMelTan here, welcome back to this channel. So before we carry on the video, I'd like to ask you guys to help me like my Facebook page and my social media, which are my TikTok, my Instagram and my Twitter. I'll be putting up a lot of other content and interesting content on those social media. Please help me like and follow up for some interesting news. So carry on this video. So today, as mentioned, we're going to answer a very interesting video. We're going to see whether can you save a bit more money if you were to pair a Core i9 on a ASUS TUF motherboard instead of a higher, more expensive board such as a Strix or even an ROG motherboard. This is also part 3 of our preview of this ASUS TUF Z490 Plus gaming Wi-Fi motherboard. And this is the day where we power on this guy. So in the previous parts, we have done the unboxing, the feature walkthrough of this motherboard. So we're going to put on some magic show, some lighting show for this motherboard. To power on motherboard, we need the CPU and as mentioned, is the Core i9-10900K. So I'd like to thank ASUS and definitely Intel for passing us this piece of CPU. This CPU uses the LGA 1200 socket on your motherboards, which are only found on the Z490 chipsets of these motherboards. It is 10 core Fini threads and it uses the 14 nanometer die manufacturing process. So it comes with a base clock of 3.7 GHz. It draws 125 watts of power. So as Gordon has mentioned, this CPU definitely draws a lot of power from the motherboard. That's why we need a hefty power supply and a good motherboard pair of it. Right now, I'd like to pass this CPU and this motherboard to Gordon to show you how the board looks like when it's powered up and to solve to this question. Gordon, please.
Hello, hi, Gordon here. In the last two parts of the video, what I did was I took you through a rundown of the Z490 TUF Gaming Wi-Fi from ASUS itself. And now we have gone on to the next stage. We have put it together into a complete system itself, as you can see right over here. So you may probably be wondering, why are we putting the top of the line i9 CPU into a mid-range motherboard such as the Z490 TUF Gaming? Well, the purpose of this little exercise is to go through the little scenario. What if you want the best CPU around, but maybe you don't want to spend too much on the other components inside your set other than the GPU if you're going for a gaming rig itself? So maybe you want to go for a mid-range Z490 instead of the top of the line Strix or Maximus series from ASUS. And maybe for the cooling for the CPU itself, we go for something a little bit more value for money, a bit more entry level in terms of pricing. Of course, first off, this is the motherboard that the i9 is sitting on. As for the CPU cooler that you see, there's this little colorful fella down here with the three ARGB fans down here, is the Silverstone PF360 itself. Now, this didn't cost me much, relatively speaking, for 360 Red. This cost me about less than Singapore $200, or in freedom money, about $140. So we have $140 cooler. We have a Z490 mid-range motherboard. Let's see how far we can take the i9. But first, I shall take you through what else is inside the test system itself. Okay, right, without further ado, I shall just take you through all what's inside this little case itself. It's the Lianli PCO11 Dynamic. This is my personal case. So first and foremost, of course, like I said earlier in the video, we have the Z490 TUF motherboard. That's what everything is sitting on itself. Then we have what's cooling the i9 itself. This is the Silverstone PF360. The block is here. The red has been mounted here as exhaust. For additional fans, we have four of our own in-house Typhoon systems 2.2K RPM fans here. Two mounted here and two mounted here. For RAM, we have a set of G-Scale Trident Z Royals 3200 CL16, 16GB. My ADATA SX8200512GB SSD is mounted right below down here on the M.2 slot with the heat shield itself. And of course, powering this entire setup itself, which is hidden behind that section over there, is the Corsair 1600i. Because I figured we're going to push this guy to the limit, we might as well get one of the best power supplies running around. So let's go on to the other parts of the video as we'll take you through on how this guy runs. Okay, right, I've just kicked off a run of Cinebench R20 itself. One thing you'll notice that if you look right over here at the setting that you remove all the limits, the all-core clock boost speed is at about 4.9 GHz. You can see 4.9 something, it floats about there. The one thing that I'd like to show you, it's getting a little bit toasty in there. It's floating at around 70 plus, the low 80s during this Cinebench R20 run. And let's scroll down to here. Yeah, your CPU package power power in excess of 200 watts. Yeah, not too sure if you saw that. Maybe I'll really give it a little run again. Yeah, let me show you that. Now it's gone to idle. So let it do another run. Yeah, you can see the CPU package power is going in excess of 200 watts. Sheesh. This is at the automatic setting, the one where you just remove all limits. The set is going at 4.9 gigahertz on all 10 of its cores during this R20 run. That's a lot of power it's drawing. Later, I'll just show you what's gonna happen when you put the limits back on. So you can see right now, yeah, the score is 6208. So I'm gonna do another run after I go inside the BIOS and make the adjustments. Okay, now we're gonna do a second run, but this one will be with the BIOS default setting, which let the motherboard handle the multi-core enhancement. So let's show you what happens, and you're gonna be surprised at what happens. Remember just now, the one with all the limiters out, that one was 6208. So let me show you the behavior that happens when we do it with the default setting. So far, it's looking okay, but if you give it a little bit of a while, something is going to happen. Ah, you can just hear the fan just spun down, right? And you just see that the clock speed just went from 4.9 to 4.2. What's going on here? Really? Okay, so it's at 4.2. Yeah, the score has dropped by 400 points in R20. That's quite significant. That's like pretty much almost a 10% drop overall. What's going on here? I'll do another run and then I'll give you my little thoughts on what I think is happening. Now remember in the first run when the limiters were removed and the set went to run, see now it's running at almost 200 watts. Well, more than 200 watts actually. Yes, and you can see in short order, it has just plunged downwards to 4.2. And you can see that the package power has dropped to 125. What is actually happening here is that this CPU is rated at 125 watt TDP. So under the default setting, the CPU will only run on this setting, that means up to 200 watts at 4.9 gigahertz at a certain preset amount of time, after which it will drop back to a clock speed that will keep it within 125 watt TDP. This is my understanding of what's going on here, but yeah, you can see on the second run, it's already affect the score. From 6.2, the first run just now was 5.8, now it's become 5.5. So for those of you who are planning to buy this new i9 for heavy CPU tasks, like maybe you're going to render on V-Ray or you're going to render on 3ds Max or Arno, that kind of thing, anything that is intense on the CPU, do take note of this behavior. Because the difference between enabled and the motherboard default auto setting, yeah, you can see it's quite substantial. And it's only going to get more substantial because actually for the rest of your render run, you will not get the benefit of 4.9 gigahertz on all 10 cores. You will get 4.2. That's quite a difference. So do take note of that. Okay, right. This is the ASUS Armoury Creator application itself. Like I told you, this is part of the part. In the BIOS, you'll find the option to have this thing auto-load when you have a new installation of Windows. So I'm just going to take you on a little brief tour of what this thing actually does. So the first option here is Aura Sync. Pretty straightforward. So you have the Aura Sync handling the RGB on the motherboard itself, the memory, as well as the addressable RGB headers down there. So these are all some of the effects. So I'll just take you to do a bit on what you have. So right now it's on rainbow. This is in rainbow mode itself. If I were to pop over to, let's say, static at white, since I've linked all the things up together, you can see the RGB on the CPU, the AIO block for the CPU is white, the fan is white, everything is pretty much white inside there. Pretty straightforward. Then I'll just go through some of the other things that are here. Okay, tools. We have this section here that allows you to update the drivers to the latest ones from ASUS themselves. We have some of the utilities here, turbo LAN, Norton security, daemon 2 lights. I'm not too sure why I have this little fetish with WinRAR, but it's here. BIOS here is blank because I've updated this to latest. You can download the manual as well as the warranty card. Yeah, a couple of other things as well. That's pretty much it. Game deals, news, whatever. And you can have some updates for these little plugins here, the Aura Kit and all that. So yeah, that takes you through on the Armoury Crate. I'd like to bring you to the other unique part about ASUS motherboards themselves. So this is the AI Suite. So you have a whole plethora of adjustments that you can do right over here. DGVRMs, you have the power plans, you can set away mode, that kind of thing. So there's a lot of things down here. I discover all of it, make this video really, really, really long. But one thing that I think that a lot of enthusiasts would really like is the fan tuner itself. What this basically does is that it just runs the fans through and then it automatically sets a fan curve based on what it tunes up. So the nice thing about this is that rather than having to go into the BIOS to adjust the fan curve, you can actually come down here and adjust and apply. So you can adjust your fan curve in real time rather than having to reboot the set every time you want to adjust the fans. So this is a good point for the ASUS AI suite itself. Let's see what else is there. I think that does the pretty much the same thing as what the Armoury crate does. Okay, one thing I liked about the Armoury crate is that when this thing loads your new installation of Windows itself, it will automatically install a copy of the drivers for the NIC on this motherboard itself, which is good because the Intel i219V in this motherboard, the drivers are not built in as part of Windows 10 1909. It's a good thing. At least when you install Windows, you already have the LAN port active already. The only improvement I really would like to see on that capability would be for them to be able to auto-load the Wi-Fi drivers as well, because there will be quite a number of people, they may not have a LAN connection anywhere for them to carry on the rest of the Windows 10 updates and installation, that kind of thing. Yeah, it'll be good that in a future update into the BIOS or something like that, they put in, like, let's say, the drivers for the Wi-Fi to auto-load along with the drivers for the LAN port as well. So yeah, that's a suggestion for ASUS. I hope they keep this into consideration. Okay, now we've come to the part of the video and it's now time to finally answer Mel's question. What if you take the i9 and if you try to pair it with the mid-range motherboard, which will be this TUF Z490 out here, what will be the end result? And the end result for my analysis and observation is this. What you're gonna have is the i9 being able to easily run on just that, changing that one setting to remove the limiters, no matter speaking. Removing the limiter allows it to be able to do 4.9 GHz on all cores without too much trouble. Of course, as what you saw in the Cinebench R20 run just now, if you were to do any form of CPU-based rendering like Cinebench, V-Ray, that kind of thing, do expect the CPU at 4.9 GHz on all 10 cores to run in excess of like 80 to 85 degrees. So bearing on this 360 mm radiators in mind, you can try and push to 5, but I tried a bit of it just now and the temperature went to like 90, 95 degrees, which is a little bit not a very comfortable place to be. So yeah, can you do it? Yes, you can, but do temper your expectations. But at 4.9 GHz on all 10 cores, you're already getting a very fast CPU. 10 cores, 20 threads. That's a lot of power already. And to buy that extra 0.1 to hit the magical number 5, I would say you will have to put quite a fair bit more investment. From what I can see so far, this motherboard can do it. I tried going to 5, it could easily do that. I tried going into 5.1, 5.2. The board can do it, but the problem is that I am somewhat restricted by that 360mm AI over there. So if you're going to try to push for 5, yes, the board can do it, but to get there, you will need to invest in something more comprehensive, like a custom loop with multiple radiators and all that. And quite frankly speaking, then you run into a little conundrum that you are spending just enough money to buy a mid-range board like this fella, and then you are taking a whole lot more money to spend on a custom loop solution. So just kind of doesn't really make any sense. So yeah, that's my take on it. You certainly can run it, but do note that on a 360mm radiator, 4.9 is about as high as you're gonna go, but it's still a very fast CPU by any means. As you saw in the gaming clips just now, you're gonna be pretty happy with it as a gaming machine for a long time to come.
Alright, thank you Gordon for this very comprehensive preview of the power of this ASUS TUF gaming motherboard. We have answered the question. You definitely can pair this mid-range motherboard with such a high-end CPU like the Core i9-10900K. But as Gordon mentioned, you will probably be stuck with 4.9 GHz, which definitely is still very high for 10 cores. But if you definitely want to squeeze out more, yeah, you probably need to go for a custom water cooling solution for your PC, which, as Gordon also mentioned, creates a kind of a weird conundrum now because that you're trying to save money on the motherboard, but then you have to spend a lot more, which is at least a few hundred dollars, a few thousand dollars for custom loop. So I'll leave you guys up to that. Let me know in the comment section if you're going to pair mid-range motherboard with such a high-end CPU, or you are really doing it, and yeah, if so, what CPU and what motherboard are you using? So if you like this video, make sure you give us a thumbs up so that we know we continue putting such videos. And in the meantime, if you've not watched the first two parts of this preview, make sure to check out parts 1 and 2 of this ASUS TUF gaming motherboard preview. So yeah, important, make sure to subscribe to our channel by clicking your eye icon and click on the bell to know when we put up new videos. So we're definitely going to put up a lot of new videos very, very soon. Yeah, so good news is that Circuit Breaker in Singapore is going to leave very soon. So I may be going back to Golden Space to film. I'm not so sure yet, but let's see what happens. So if you don't want to miss that, make sure to return to our channel by clicking on the subscribe button. So for Gordon and I, we are out.